things like an informant came in off the street to the FBI in Miami. There's things like that that are filtering in.
Good morning, Stryker.
Good morning, Professor.
Having some trouble.
Yeah, what is this thing?
That, my friend, is a tape recorder.
I can't get it to work.
It's quite simple, really. Just press here until it clicks.
The only way to solve this, and we're set up beautifully to do it, for us to have Walters call Pat Gray and just say, this is business here, we don't want you going any further.
What are you listening to?
I don't know. I just found these tapes in the courtroom. They say Nixon on them.
As in President Nixon?
I think so.
That's not unusual.
Wasn't he the only president of the United States to resign from office?
Yes, he was.
Why?
To avoid prosecution. He was involved in illegal activity and learned the hard way that even he wasn't above the law.
Ooh, this is a story I gotta hear.
President Nixon had just barely begun his second term as President of the United States when five burglars were convicted and sentenced to prison for breaking and entering the Democratic National Headquarters in Washington, D.C.
And President Nixon was involved somehow?
It was believed so.
Why would he do that?
It was an election year, so the pressure was on. President Nixon's Republican re-election committee apparently thought they could gain an advantage by photographing campaign documents and tapping the phone lines of important people in the Democratic Party.
So they hired burglars to break in?
Allegedly. The burglars were, however, arrested later that night at the Watergate office complex.
Where the Democratic National Headquarters were?
Yes. It was June 17, 1972. And Watergate had just begun.
So, how did they link the burglars back to Nixon?
Well, 2 days after the arrest was made, it was reported that a GOP security aide was among the Watergate burglars. Then, a $25,000 cashier's check, which had been earmarked for Nixon's re-election campaign, wound up in the bank account of a Watergate burglar.
Yipes! That's incriminating.
But neither was enough to stop Nixon from being re-elected in one of the largest landslide votes in American history. It wasn't until the trial of the burglars that things started to heat up around the president. Five of the seven indicted men pleaded guilty, while former Nixon aides Gordon Liddy and James McCord were convicted of conspiracy, burglary, and illegal wiretapping. However, after the trial, McCord claimed that the defendants had been coerced into pleading guilty. He also said that some of the witnesses had committed perjury.
Perjury? Oh my! Perjury? Isn't that when someone lies under oath during official proceedings?
Yes, that's correct. By April, two of Nixon's top White House staff and the Attorney General had resigned over the scandal, and White House counsel John Dean was fired. Things were really beginning to unravel. And then, there were the tapes.
The tapes? What tapes? Like mine?
Yes, kind of like yours. In July of 1973, Alexander Butterfield, a White House aide, testified to Congress that the president had a secret taping system in the Oval Office.
For what?
He had been recording all of his phone calls and conversations since 1971.
Oh boy.
Nixon ordered the White House taping system disconnected after Watergate Special Prosecutor Archibald Cox subpoenaed the tapes. Nixon delivered transcripts of the conversations, but not the actual tapes, citing executive privilege.
What's that?
Executive privilege allows members of the executive branch, including the president, to keep some communications confidential.
I see. So, was Nixon allowed to keep his taped conversations confidential?
No, but he did his best to impede the investigation by firing Cox and abolishing the Office of Special Prosecutor.
Sounds reasonable.
6 months later, the White House released more than 1,200 pages of edited transcripts of the tapes to the House Judiciary Committee. A couple of weeks later, after reading through the transcripts, the committee opened impeachment hearings against the president.
Impeachment? Like the fruit?
Oh, no, of course not. Impeachment is the process by which a public official, like the president, can be removed for misconduct while in office.
Oh,
Then, on July 24th, the Supreme Court ruled unanimously that tape recordings of 64 White House conversations must be released.
So much for executive privilege.
The court held that the party requesting the documents had to make a sufficient showing that the presidential material was essential to the justice of the case, and concluded that the special prosecutor had done so. Chief Justice Warren Burger also clarified that executive privilege would most often apply when it came to matters of national security. In this case, however, it was not a matter of national security, but rather a question of criminal activity involving the office of the president. 3 days later, the House Judiciary Committee passed the first of three articles of impeachment, charging the president with obstruction of justice. President Nixon met with the Senate and House minority leaders, who told him that they were certain he would not have enough votes to withstand impeachment. So, on August 9, 1974, Nixon resigned. He asked the nation to support their new president, Gerald Ford, who had been Nixon's vice president.
So, what was on the tapes?
Well, let's just say there was enough evidence to sway public opinion about the integrity of the president. First, one of the tapes, nicknamed the Smoking Gun Tape, demonstrated that Nixon had been told about the White House connection to the Watergate burglary soon after they happened. Nixon was heard approving plans to interfere with the investigation. Therefore, he obstructed justice. Then, there was the missing 18 and a half minutes, which the president's secretary said she accidentally wiped while transcribing the contents of the tape.
Really? She said that?
Yes, and most people didn't believe her either.
Sounds a little shady.
Yes, it did. And although it didn't prove any wrongdoing by the president, it certainly created suspicion of a cover-up, which ultimately led to his resignation.
Was the president charged with any crimes?
No, he wasn't. He was granted a full pardon by his successor, President Gerald Ford.
I see. So, how do I get this tape recorder to record things? I want to remember something I learned.
Oh, well, that's simple. Press this button, and this red button too, and you're recording.
Hello out there! Today I learned that President Nixon should probably not have recorded all of his conversations. Likewise, I should probably not try to record every moment of my life. Hold on.
What are you doing?
Taking a selfie of me and this vintage tape recorder.
Play that back.
Huh? Likewise, I should probably not try to record every moment of my life. Oh, I guess maybe some things should just be remembered by my brain.
You make a good point. Well, what would you like to learn about next?